Well, nursing is currently the fastest growing occupation in the nation. Everything from an aging population to a shrinking nursing workforce has demand at an all-time high. And recent nursing graduates enjoy some of the highest starting salaries among their peers. Yet many new nurses do not stay with it. In fact, almost half will leave the profession in their first year. But a nursing program at Oklahoma Baptist University hopes to lower those numbers by giving their graduates the confidence that only experience can bring. We went inside their simulation training labs for a lesson in technology with a healthy dose of humanity added in.
Okay, man, I just hope that doctor gets here soon.
Meet Nicole Jackson, director of the nursing simulation labs at OBU.
We're gonna get your bed ready, okay?
We're gonna go ahead and put you in a position.
I'm so ready to see this baby.
We're excited for you.
This is their safe space to learn. This is their safe container. They can come here, think outside the box. They can be the nurse. In the hospital, often they're with a nurse. In sim lab, they are the nurse for that patient that day. They're making the decisions. They are the ones that have to go in, assess the situation, use clinical reasoning, notify who, you know, the physician, dietary, case management, who, whatever that patient needs are, they need to access those resources and utilize them. So they're the thinking brain when they're in sim. They're the doer.
The first time I ever did it, it was rather intimidating. You can't really plan for something like this situation. Even if you read it in your textbooks, actually doing it in a simulation lab is completely different, and it's quite amazing.
All right, the baby's out. You did great.
Oh my goodness.
You did great.
So what was it like before this technology?
Before this technology, that's when I was in school. And so I know what it was like then. We would have labs. We did have more static mannequins, so you didn't have as much response from the patient, if that's what, you know, you can kind of visualize. So you might have a mannequin in the bed or another person. We do it on each other, right? We practice on each other, but you know, you really don't always want to practice IVs on each other or NG tubes. That's not always the most comfortable thing. Now with simulation, you're able to stay in the role a little bit deeper and a little bit longer and more intently, and so I think it just kind of takes it up a notch from where we were. So we were at a decent place, and nursing's always been innovative, and we always have kind of thought on our feet. But with this technology, the sky's the limit.
Oh, thank you so much.
No problem. All right, Paula, we're gonna put your legs back in the normal position in the bed that you were before you had Wellness Jade, okay?
Okay.
All right.
You can read all day long in a textbook, but when you come in here and you have them say whatever they're going to say, you can't plan for anything. And so it's really good to have that real life scenario of, like, you really don't know what's going to happen next. And so it makes you become more confident, and you have to rely on the base knowledge you have already.
Your role in there is also almost theatric.
Yes, it is.
Do you enjoy doing that?
I do. I've always heard, or a few times I've heard, education or part of teaching is, you know, about 70 to 75% theatrics and 20 to 25 or 30% preparation. You know what I mean? You kind of put that together, and you have to prepare, but then you have to be willing to get into it so that the students get into it. It's not just a fake mannequin in the bed. It's a person that they're hearing and seeing and responding to.
She's got an Apgar score of 9, so that's really good.
You have to deal with the patient's emotions. You're seeing people at some of their strongest points and their weakest points in life, so you really need to be able to provide that comfort and that positive support that they need when they are facing pain and sickness and just the trials that they're going through.
I can't breathe. VTAC in room 149. Code blue.
Yeah, all right, here we go.
10 of Epi.
1, 2.
Is it still real?
4, 5.
Yeah. In the moment, you're just so into it, and you know what you've learned in class, but you're doing it, and you know that I have to keep going, that I need to switch off, and it felt pretty real to me.
The young lady we saw doing the compressions.
Yes.
You could tell that was real to her.
Yes. And that's one of the beauties of sim. You get in there, and you start going, and it's almost as when you first walk in, you might see the mannequin in the bed, but the more the professor's into it, the more realistic you are. They all have roles. You know, she was the primary nurse. She knew that patient was her responsibility. When the code team was called, they all knew what their roles were. When the physician came in, the physician had the badge. They knew what who the physician was. You know, they all had their roles, and they knew what to do. And when she's doing the CPR, that's real. That's a patient. She got report on the patient. you know, she came in to take care of the patient, and the patient started having, you know, a course of a bad outcome, and she had to respond. Because if she didn't, the patient would have resulted in death. And so, I mean, she had to respond in that moment. And once you begin that response, and the patient's responding too, and you kind of have all of the realism, that's why it's so important to put your mannequins in the situation that looks like a hospital room. Because the more that we're in it, and the more it looks and feels just like the setting you're gonna be in, the more your brain kicks in and says, this is real. And the more real it will be one day when she's with a real patient, she's gonna know exactly what to do and exactly how to respond. And that patient will hopefully have a good outcome because of her practice here.
I think it's incredible experience learning. I'm always nervous in sim, like I start sweating. But in this situation, I love that we were able to do something, and I feel a lot more confident to go out into a hospital and do it from things like this.
All right, I'm not feeling a pulse. Looks like we
still. Why do you do this?
Because I love it.
Simple enough.
Patients matter. And patient lives matter. That's why I'm a nurse. I'm called to do this. I don't believe you can be an effective nurse if you're not called. And I know wholeheartedly I'm called to be a nurse. I believe these students are called as well. And if this is a way for me to best serve my patients, training the new century and the new, you know, era of nurses is probably one of the most important things that I can do for my profession and for the patients that I love and want to serve.
A quick side note, I'm sure you noticed that Nicole has no hair or eyebrows, and while she's not sick, she was diagnosed with a rare form of alopecia at age 10. Now, before our interview, I spoke with her about what it was like growing up while looking different, and her answer was so enlightening, I have it streaming on our website under our value-added section.